Hello students, myself Suresh, welcoming you to this small session. In this session, we are going to see the mechanism of urine formation. Here, the mechanism of urine formation involves four stages. First one, glomerular filtration and tubular reabsorption, tubular secretion, and the last step is formation of hypertonic urine. So let us start with the first step, glomerular filtration. You know already in our previous class we have seen the structure of nephron with a Malpighian body which contain Bowman's capsule and glomerulus. Here how this glomerulus will filter we have to see. Firstly, the blood flows inside the glomerulus under the influence of pressure due to the narrowness of afferent arteriole. Means here through afferent arteriole the blood enters the glomerulus, but as the afferent arteriole is narrow, there is some pressure exerted within the glomerulus that squeezes the vasus into the Bowman's capsule. So here that is why it is called pressure filtration or ultra filtration. Generally, waste molecules and nutrient molecules, means which are excess, and water are filtered out and enter the Bowman's capsule from the glomerulus. Next step, tubular reabsorption, means after crossing the Bowman's capsule through podocyte cells, the filtrate will enter into the Bowman's capsule, and the first part of the Bowman's capsule is PCT, proximal convoluted tubule, so it enters into the tubular part. So here in the second step, tubular reabsorption. Reabsorption in the sense, whatever filtered in the Bowman's capsule can be reabsorbed. So here filtrate from the glomerulus is also called primary urine, means which is filtered in the Bowman's capsule is primary urine, which is almost equal to the blood in chemical composition except the presence of blood cells. Means the primary urine which is formed, which is coming out of the Bowman's capsule, is having equal composition with the blood except the presence of blood cells. Means excluding blood cells, remaining composition of blood is equal to this primary urine composition. It will pass us into the proximal convoluted tubule. The peritubular capillaries around the PCT, you know already there are capillaries around the tubular part, renal tubule. Peritubular capillaries will reabsorb the useful components of the primary urine, such as glucose, amino acids, vitamin C, potassium, calcium, sodium, chlorides, and 75% of the water can be reabsorbed by the peritubular capillaries in the PCT. Right, and the next third step. So before going to see third step, you can see here the afferent arteriole will enter into the Bowman's capsule, and the efferent arteriole which is coming out is moving along with the tubular part. You can see here, right, it is going in contact with the tubular part. So you can understand now why it is moving along with the tubular part. To reabsorb from the primary urine, which is now passing through the tubular part, PCT, loop of Henle, and DCT. So that is the second step, reabsorption. So what was reabsorbed here from the primary urine? Glucose, amino acids, vitamin C, potassium, calcium, sodium, chlorides, and 75% of the water. You see, all these are required by our body. So our body don't want to let these useful substances out from the body in the form of urine. That is why what is happening in the second step, reabsorption of all these substances have been done, right? And the third step is tubular secretion. It is again reverse process. It is not absorption, it is secretion. It is the active secretion in the sense it is not by any simple diffusion or osmosis, it is by consuming energy. So it is the active secretion of waste products by blood capillaries into the urinary tubule. Means whatever the substances reabsorbed, if that substance are not necessary to the body, if they are harmful, if they are waste, then again the removal of waste is tubular secretion. It ensures remove of all the waste products from the blood. So what are that wastes here secreted back into the urine? Urea, uric acid, creatinine, salt ions like potassium, sodium and hydrogen ions. This maintain proper concentration and pH of urine. Right, this is the third step, tubular secretion. What is happening in this step? From the blood, again from the blood, the waste is sending back into the urine. That is tubular secretion, right? And next, third, last step is formation of hypertonic urine, formation of concentrated urine. Here 75% of water content of nephric filtrate is reabsorbed in the region of PCT, right? When the primary urine enters into the tubular part, at PCT 75% of water is reabsorbed. 10% of water passes out of filtrate through osmosis in the area of loop of Henle, in the loop of Henle region, right? You know already the loop of Henle, which connects PCT and DCT, which is U shape. So there 10% of water is passes out of filtrate, means again the 10% of water is removed from the urine. Further concentration of urine takes place in the area of collecting tubes in the presence of hormone called vasopressin, right? Here we have to talk particularly about a hormone that is vasopressin. This hormone secreted only when concentrated urine is to be passed out. You have to listen carefully here. When the hormone is produced, which hormone it is? Vasopressin. When it is produced? It is produced when there is a need to excrete concentrated urine. Concentrated urine. When there will be a need arise to excrete concentrated urine? When the water levels in the body are low. When the water is not sufficiently present in the body, then our body will try to excrete concentrated urine. Means it will absorb, it will reabsorb maximum water, right? To avoid dehydration of our body, it will absorb maximum water that will make the urine much concentrated. So absence of vasopressin produces diluted urine. If vasopressin is not produced, it will lead to excrete diluted urine, means it will not let the body to reabsorb the water. Means when it happens like that, when we drink water sufficiently, if there are sufficient water levels in the body, the hormone will not be produced, right? Why it is not produced? There is no need of reabsorbing much water. There is no need to make the urine much concentrated. Let the water go, then the hormone will not be produced. But when the hormone will produce, when there is a need to excrete concentrated urine. So that is what, how the vasopressin is affecting the concentration of urine. Here we have to talk about a disease called diabetes insipidus. Diabetes, you know already diabetes, but it is diabetes insipidus which leads to more urination. So that is caused due to the deficiency of vasopressin. You know already just now, if the hormone is not produced, the diluted urine to be passed out, it will not make the urine concentrated, right? So that leads to more rate of urination. So the deficiency of vasopressin causes excessive repeated dilute urination. That is called diabetes insipidus. How diabetes insipidus is caused? Due to deficiency of vasopressin. What vasopressin will do? It will concentrate, it will make the urine concentrated. Here, when the urine is concentrated, it will collected into ureters. So you can see that ureter part here, the ureters will collect the urine from the kidneys, and that ureter will take the urine into the urinary bladder, right? From the urinary bladder through urethra, the urine is expelled out. Right? This is how the urine is formed and excreted out.